Good morning, everybody. Good morning. How are we this morning? Good. Yeah. Some have traveled far and wide to be here, right? So welcome to everybody who joins us. It is a wonderful opportunity that we have to gather together. Some of you might be aware that it is actually Ascension Sunday. So Ascension is celebrated on the Thursday before. But for us, and in the history of our Reformed tradition, Ascension was seen as a monumental redemptive event, as it is, in which the one who descended for our salvation ascended so that it might be applied through the work of the Spirit. So this is a good thing, and we will take time during our worship to praise our God in heaven for the ascension of his Son through the recitation of various psalms and the singing of certain songs and the meditation on what that ascension and exaltation means for God's work of redemption and salvation for us. So we're blessed to be able to do that today. If you have your bulletin, just look at the front page here. That's where our announcements are located for this morning. You'll see that we will have our coffee connection immediately following our service this morning after we partake of the Lord's Supper, and then we'll have Sunday school. I believe it is Lucas who will be teaching the adults, right? Lucas, you ready to go? Yeah? You look pumped.
Never ready.
I thought you said ever ready, but no. Okay. All right. Ever ready, never ready. Sometimes they're close together. And so Lucas will be leading, and then we'll have the kiddos upstairs. So it'll be a nice blessed time there of instruction. And then this evening at 5 p.m., we will have our third Sunday fellowship at the McCracken's house, at the McCracken's. If you have not had a chance already to let the McCracken's know, if you'll be attending, please do so at your earliest convenience. Otherwise, Joel and I will have to eat 20 hot dogs apiece, you know, and while that might be fun in the first two, right, then the last 18 would be tough. So that's not our plan. What's that? And Chipotle. That's a totally different story. Yes, that's right. Well, on Wednesday, we'll have our prayer meeting at 6:30. And then on Saturday, not this upcoming Saturday, but on the 17th of June, please mark it in your calendar. We've already spoken about it in some length previously, but on the 17th Saturday, we'll have our church work day. That'll be from 9 to roughly 12. So please mark that in your calendar, and the deacons have already assembled a good list, and we'll have an opportunity to gather together and to help beautify the church, address some issues, and do it in the service of the Lord and his ministry. So those are our announcements that we have today. Are there any that I am missing that we should add? Seeing nothing more, let's begin our worship. Will you stand with me and take your bulletin? Our call to worship comes from Psalm 24, verses 3 through 10. Of course, this is a psalm that is fulfilled, as they all are in Jesus Christ, but particularly in his ascension, as he ascends not into any earthly mountain or residence, but instead into heavenly Zion, the mount on which the Lord is dwell, a mount that we have been speaking about in our sermon series in Exodus. And he goes so that he might make atonement for our sins, but also that he might take his rightful place at the right hand of God in heaven as our King of glory, who has conquered sin and death on our behalf and now reigns on high. So this is responsive. I'll read those portions in the light print and ask that you respond by reading the portions in the bold. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place?
He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false, and does not swear deceitfully.
He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation.
Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory?
The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory?
The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory.
Let's pray together.
O Lord, we are grateful that as we pray this morning, We can praise you that the King of Glory, that this one, Jesus, he ascended on high through gates of pearl, and he did so as a conquering king, having defeated sin and death, which could not hold him in the grave, but he had overcome through his atonement. And he ascended to your very right hand. He had won that victory, and he is continuing to be victorious and triumphant as he puts every enemy, every threat, every obstacle to your plan of redemption under his feet, so that he might present a new order, a new heavens, and a new earth to you, so that we might reign with you through all eternity. And we here who are here at Redeemer on this Sunday morning, our instinct might be to be sad, to feel deprived that our King, the one who walked amongst us even as he battled sin and death, that he is no longer with us on this terrestrial sphere. But as he told his disciples, and as his disciples told us, that is to our benefit, because he sent his Spirit so that we too might be equipped for discipleship and evangelism. We too might be equipped even this morning to worship you in spirit and in truth, so that we might participate in glorifying and honoring and praising your holy name. And as we do so, we might bear witness to this King of Glory who has ascended on high, and that many others might join our voices and join our hearts as we praise you and as we praise your plan of redemption that has established a kingdom that can never be thwarted and a king that will reign over us in goodness, justice, and peace. It gives us purpose this morning as we worship you. It gives us joy, and it gives us hope of everlasting life before you. We thank you, Lord. May our worship reflect this gratitude. May it reflect this wondrous plan of salvation in our King of Glory. In whose name we pray. Amen. Well, friends, let's recite the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, if you remain standing for a little bit longer here before we turn to sing, it is fitting that as we turn to sing from Psalm 24 in our Trinity hymnal, that we think a little bit more about the exaltation in the ascension. And so we have question 53 from the Westminster Larger Catechism along with its answer. I'll read the question and ask that together as the congregation would read the answer. So how was Christ exalted in his ascension? Christ was exalted in his ascension in that having after his resurrection often appeared unto and conversed with his apostles, speaking to them of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and giving them commission to preach the gospel to all nations. 40 days after his resurrection, he, in our nature and as our head, triumphing over enemies, visibly went up into the highest heavens, there to receive gifts for men, to raise up our affections thither, and to prepare a place for us, where himself is and shall continue till his second coming at the end of the world. You see, it was to our benefit that Christ would ascend on high so that we might have gifts, and part of that gifts is the lavishness of the Spirit so that we can sing with hearts full of truth and full of joy. We're going to do so now by taking our Trinity hymnal, turning to number 292 to sing, Who Shall Ascend the Mountain of the Lord? I will say this, I look forward to this Sunday for many different reasons each and every year, but this is one of my favorite songs, and so I get to coerce Glenn to sing it, you know, like to choose it for us, so that we can sing this song. It's a beautiful one. 292.
Search the being alone, whose hands and heart are pure. One servant of the Lord with purpose sure can enter in that glory to endure. Alleluia. He only can ascend to God's right hand, who first came down as his
seated. Glenn's going to come forward for us now, and he's going to lead us in our time of intercession, and then a little bit more instruction from the Catechism.
We're actually going to turn to our next question from the Catechism, question 54. You can see it printed there for you in the bulletin. Again, speaking of the ascension and exaltation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Question 54 asks, how is Christ exalted in his sitting at the right hand of God? Christ is exalted in his sitting at the right hand of God, in that as God-man, he is advanced to the highest favor with God the Father, with all fullness of joy, glory, and power over all things in heaven and earth, and doth gather and defend his church, and subdue their enemies, furnisheth his ministers and people with gifts and graces, and makes intercession for them. Let's take a moment now to quiet our hearts and come before the Lord and bring him our requests together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning that you have sent your Son, the Lord Jesus, that he took on human flesh, that he lived among us, that he obeyed you perfectly, that he suffered for sins, that he rose again from the dead, and that he ascended and is seated now at your right hand. This is a marvelous truth, that ascension and that enthronement of the Lord Jesus means so much for us, and so we thank you for it. We thank you that when we come to the Lord Jesus, even as we do it now in prayer, that we come to a God who intercedes for us with the Father. We come to the Lord Jesus who is ready and willing to give good gifts to his church, to strengthen, equip it, to gather and defend it. We thank you for this beautiful truth, and we pray this morning that you would give us truly thankful hearts for your great goodness to us, that we can come knowing that all our requests are heard by you, that we are cared for, that we are loved, that we are listened to. And we do that now. We come to you with our requests and ask you to hear us. Lord, for members of our congregation who are suffering or in distress of various ways, we pray for healing and for relief. We continue to pray for our brother Dave Shaver. We thank you for some improvement in his condition. We pray that you continue to heal Dave. We pray for Lauren as she walks beside him and encourages him. We pray that you'd strengthen her in that. Lord, we pray for those in our congregation that that struggle with long-term illnesses. We pray for Laura and for Joni, for your healing upon them. We pray for Tony McCracken. Ask that you would continue to heal and sustain Tony through her various illnesses and struggles. Lord, we pray for Joy Parker's uncle, John. We know that he's been an important person in her life. And so we pray as he struggles physically, that you would be close to him, that you would remind him of your good and precious promises made in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you would bring healing and relief according to your will, and that you would comfort Joy and the rest of the family at this time. We give you thanks this morning for the legacy of Tim Keller and Harry Rieger, both of them men who you blessed and equipped to serve our church. And we give you thanks that even now they are in your presence. They're in the very presence of that risen and ascended Christ. And we thank you for the gifts that you gave them for the edification of the church. And we pray for comfort for their families and for their congregations as they mourn their loss. Lord, we pray for the various ministries that we support and participate in. We pray for the work of Redeemer Classical Christian School, for its teachers and staff members, its parents and students. As we finish our year, we pray that you would give us the grace to finish our year well, that in everything we do, we would bring glory to you and give you thanks for the ways that you've blessed our school community in the year that's passed. Lord, we continue to pray for Jacob and Pay Jason and the work of RUFI. As their year winds down as well, we pray that the summer that's ahead would also be a fruitful time for ministry, that you would provide rest and recovery for Jacob and Pay, and present them with new opportunities to continue to share the good news about Jesus Christ with people from all over the world. We pray for John and Gwen Ciccone and their work in Africa, for safe travels for them, and that you would continue to bless the work that they are doing there. Lord, we pray also for the work of crisis pregnancy centers in our community, particularly for Care First. And we pray that you would continue to provide for and equip these ministries to serve the women and the children of our community that are vulnerable, that are hurt or confused. We pray for strength in the work that they do. Lord, we also pray for our greater community. Lord, we ask that you would give those who have authority in our state and in our nation, that you'd give them wisdom, that you would give them humility, that everything that they do would be done in the fear of the Lord, that they would seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Lord, we pray that for our president, Joe Biden, for our governor, Wes Moore, for all those who represent us. We pray for our first responders and our military, our law enforcement officials, that they would all act justly and carefully, that they would be compassionate, that you would protect them and strengthen them in the important work that they do. As we continue in worship this morning, we pray that you would be honored by our singing, that you would hear our prayers, that you would make your word effective as it's preached to us, that it would change us through the work of the Holy Spirit. And we pray all of these things for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Justin's going to come now and lead us in our reading of God's word from Exodus 25.
Well, if you're staying with me as we turn to Exodus chapter 25, we're going to be in verses 23 through 30 this morning. Of course, we're working through the instructions for the tabernacle, both in the overall structure, but also in the furniture. Having looked at the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat last week, we'll move on to the table for this week. I'll begin at verse 23. You shall make a table of acacia wood. 2 cubits shall be its length, 1 cubit its breadth, and 1.5 cubits its height. You shall overlay it with pure gold and make a molding of gold around it. That should be familiar to us, as we saw with the Ark of the Covenant. But here's something new. You shall make a rim around it, 1 hand breadth wide, and a molding of gold around the rim. And you shall make for it 4 rings of gold and fasten the rings to the 4 corners at its 4 legs. Close to the frame, the rings shall lie as holders for the poles to carry the table. You shall make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold, and the table shall be carried with these. And you shall make its plates and dishes for incense, and its flagons and bowls with which to pour drink offerings. You shall make them of pure gold. And you shall set the bread of the presence on the table before me regularly. With the sense God's reading in response, let's remain standing and sing the Gloria Patri together. Please be seated. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. O Lord, we come before you now in this worship that we have embarked on this morning, that we do week in and week out. We come before you in your word. This is a means by which you speak to us. You speak to us grace and mercy, words of comfort for your people, words of hope, words of love. We are privileged to hear them, but we cannot and will not hear them if we do not come in faith, if we do not come in the spirit of our ascended, exalted King. Instead, the sound will be like clashing cymbals. It'll be discord. It'll be unimportant. It'll be forgettable from the moment that we walk out of this sanctuary. But Lord, may it not be so for us. May these words, these eternal words, be so precious that we take them into our heart and they transform us. We, the people of the book, becoming more like the main character, the protagonist of this book. That one Jesus, loving our Father even as he has loved you and brought us in to true peace and fellowship with you. May these words do all those things and more. In Jesus' name we pray and ask. Amen. Well, as we've read here from Exodus chapter 25, our passage today involves a dining table in arguably the most formal setting ever. I mean, if we were to call for ourselves the layout of the tabernacle, just a few feet to the right is the very residence, at least earthly speaking, of Almighty God, of Yahweh God. I don't think it gets more formal than that. And so it got me thinking a little bit about the development of formal dining. Now, I'm sure that amongst this congregation, there might be some Downton Abbey folk, so you're already out ahead of me on this. But I had never given it much thought more than seeing all those different meals as they're represented on that show. So I hadn't given it all that much thought, so I decided to do a little bit of research into formal dining. Yes,
That is how much I love and care about you, that I would take the time to try to understand formal dining as it has developed throughout the ages and come down to us here in modern America. And I'll admit, even though my research was relatively limited, right, there was much more out there than perhaps even I expected there to be. Nonetheless, it was still fascinating. It was a fascinating adventure to kind of see this development and all of the nuance and characteristics of it. From the history of dining's development, particularly in the Western Hemisphere, I got to travel along these developments in Italy and then France and ultimately Russia, which I believe dining for us today is most influenced by, to the exact location of the settings, right? Does anybody know a little bit about these things? It's rather fascinating, the form and structure of each of these formal settings. From the exact location of the various pieces on the table, right? I'm going to teach you a little something here if you don't already know. Maybe all of you do, and I'm just a big troglodyte here, right? But all of the forks go on which side of the plate? The left side, right? The left side, except which fork? Does anybody know? There is one exception, at least in the most current formal arrangement. There's one exception. Anybody know what that is? Oh, joy? Very close, right? The salad fork goes all the way on the left, because if I understand right, you're supposed to put the forks that you will use first all the way on the left and work inward. But there's one fork, a little fork. What's that? Dessert fork, that goes above the plate. That's a good guess. Talis? Pickle fork? I don't know if pickles are a formal part of dining. I mean, they might be at our house. Pickle jar in the middle, right? Everybody goes for it. But no, like anybody, any other guesses? Seafood fork, Joy. It would be Joy, wouldn't it? Right? The seafood. What's it? Did you get a prize? Sure, right? You know, that's right. There's a plate of oysters. Seafood oyster, right, fork is on the far right. It's on the far right. Okay, here's another one. How far away should the knife be, your main knife, from the water glass? Do you know this? Anybody follow this? Yeah, Caleb. Very close. Very close. Mimi? To go a little colder here, 1 inch on your right, the water glass should be 1 inch from your primary knife, right? And just maybe one more here. Where does the salt go? Where does the salt go? Yeah, Caleb. That's a good guess, right? As according to formal dining arrangements, each person should have their own butter dish as well as their own salt. And it should go on your right hand because more people use salt than pepper, so it should be more readily available. And I think that's a general rule in dining. Those things that you're going to use most frequently should be toward your right hand. And apparently, there's this whole art of where to place cups, which you have the most creative license with, like your wine glass and your various goblets. So, like, this is a real thing, folks. You know, like, this is a real thing. And that doesn't even begin to talk about the selection of and seating arrangement of guests. Right? Sometimes we think about this as well. When you have guests here, right, there's purposefulness behind your choice of where to seat them. It can be as much as to cultivate conversation or relationships, or even more, it's even a means and a way to give prestige and honor to certain folk. And all of these things that I've just described, right, from time, place, position, all of these things, and more are carefully crafted and executed to achieve various purposes. Right? They're generally speaking, they're not meant to be arbitrary. And we know this, of course, to some extent in our own homes, formal or informal. By the way, we appropriate some of these items both in our daily or perhaps irregular settings at the dinner table, right? In our culture, we all eat, of course, and at various times, we all have gatherings around the table. They can be special times for us, or they can just be mundane times, but we're all accustomed in some way to the purposeful choices that we make at dining because it's a pivotal event in the daily as well as the more formal special occasions of our life. What's the point of all this? Who you invite and how you arrange a table, particularly in its most formal settings, it speaks to the nature of your relationship with them, as well as for the purpose of your coming together. And in Exodus 25, 23 through 30, we see Yahweh God commission a very special table. This is a very special table. Historically, this has been called the table of the showbread. Do we know that? Like, do we know where that language came in, the table of the showbread? It's not a one-for-one correlation. Caleb, you know this? I didn't know this. Teach me.
Well, I don't know. Now I'm going to take a guess.
Guess away.
Israel.
Okay, well, yes, absolutely, this table originates in Israel. I was thinking more, maybe my question wasn't as direct as it needed to be. The actual language of the showbread. It was Martin Luther who is one. He called it the Schaubrot. And then it came in as a calc, right, a copy exactly into the English language by Wycliffe, right, who called it the showbread as well. And it still exists today. Like, we still use this language of the table of the showbread. Well, God commissions this table for this bread of the presence, for this showbread, in a holy place. It's adjacent, as I've already described, to the most holy place, where the Ark of the Covenant, which we learned about last week, where it rests. And he does so in order to reveal to the old covenant church something in this table about both his presence as well as his provision. You see, there's purpose in this table with regard to his special presence as host and with regard to the provision that he gives to his guests. First, the presence through the table. Again, we see some more language about this table in Leviticus chapter 24, verses 5 through 9. I'm going to read for us here now. You shall take fine flour and bake 12 loaves from it. 2/10 of an ephah shall be in each loaf. And you shall set them in 2 piles, 6 in a pile on the table of pure gold before the Lord. And you shall put pure frankincense on each pile, perhaps we might say to the side of the pile, that it may go with the bread as a memorial portion, as a food offering to the Lord. Every Sabbath day, Aaron shall arrange it before the Lord, before Yahweh, regularly. It is from the people of Israel as a covenant forever. And it shall be for Aaron and his sons, and they shall eat it in a holy place. Since it is for him a most holy portion out of the Lord's food offerings, a perpetual due. You see, the purpose of this meal, what some might argue, it was to feed Yahweh God. Now, they would have gotten this understanding from other ancient Near Eastern cultures who had temples and shrines that were dedicated to the daily feeding and providing for the deity that was worshipped there. As a matter of fact, many of these structures that we see in ancient records kept large quantities of food at hand, sometimes extremely lavish and extremely rich, for this purpose alone: to present the food before the idol each and every day in various ritualistic fashion, whether that was actually bringing the food up to the idol or having the idol walk by the food. There were various practices that were done, all somehow imitating this feeding of the god. The people were feeding the god. Texts from Egypt, Anatolia, and Mesopotamia all attest to these daily rituals in these sanctuary and shrines that were spread out throughout the ancient world, from Mesopotamia to Syria and the Levant, all the way down to Egypt. But in our accounts from Exodus and from Leviticus, we see a very different picture than that which is attested in other cultures, a similar time and milieu. 12 basic loaves are set out. Of course, these 12 loaves represent the 12 tribes of Israel. And there's frankincense for aromatics, right? That's placed on the plates that are described here. And then there are jugs which are for drink offerings. But notice, they are left out for the entire week. Did you see that? There is no ritual or procession that is described here. Instead, they are left out for a week, only to be replaced on each Sabbath day, with the old loaves being consumed by whom? Being consumed by the priests, by Aaron and his family. with no prescribed ritual for the feeding of Yahweh, but instead in the holy place for the priests who serve before God. On the contrary, what we seem to have here is a reenactment, a transference of the event that we already witnessed in Exodus chapter 24. Do you remember that? When Moses, Aaron, Hur are called up to the halfway point of Mount Sinai, and they feast before the Lord in peace rather than in judgment. And they have this wonderful vision, this heavenly vision of Yahweh God's own sanctuary, which is shining down from above at the top of the mountain, demonstrating to them that they are feasting with the Lord in covenant fellowship and in covenant peace. And now Yahweh has recreated Sinai through the tabernacle. You remember that's one of the purposes here of this tabernacle, both in the way it looks, but also in its theology, right? Also in its meaning. He has replaced it, and he's instituted this meal that he did only with those elders in that one time in Exodus chapter 24. Instead, he's instituted this meal perpetually in the reception room to his most holy place. In a reception room. It sits adjacent to his very footstool, that nexus between heaven and earth, so that all of the 12 tribes represented here, represented through Aaron, they might have covenant fellowship, covenant peace with him. This is why it is called the bread of the presence, because the primary purpose of God's covenantal relationship is to have intimate fellowship, intimate presence with his people. Because think about this, as this is enacted week in and week out on the Sabbath day, it is done in a location in the very midst of the camp, right? The people are all around, and this is symbolic that the greatest blessing that God might give to his people is to dwell among them, is to be with them. And this bread of the presence, this table on which it is set, is meant to symbolize that God, in fact, dwells covenantally with this people. It is a blessing, but in order for fellowship, for God's dwelling to occur, God is the one who must provide it. You see, that is laid out here in the instructions that are given in Exodus as well as Leviticus. God must provide it. And with regard to this provision through the table, the next thing we'll talk about here, the first thing we might say is that this is, of course, represented in some way on a cosmic scale. Remember that when we introduced the tabernacle and these instructions and ultimately the construction that will follow, one of the things that I highlighted is that there is cosmic symbolism in the tabernacle. The table certainly symbolizes God's provision of food and drink for all mankind as the creator and as the king of the universe. Remember, it is a king who is instituting this meal. It is a king who gives lavish gifts to all of his creation. We see this here in Eden. God gives mankind a bounty to eat. Remember from Genesis chapter 2, verse 9. And out of the ground the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, and good for food. Psalm 136:25 says much the same. He gives food to all flesh, for his steadfast love endures forever. But we don't want to stop here, of course, right? We want to press farther and to see in the tabernacle and the bread of the presence what we have been talking about up to this point is a partial restoration of the Garden of Eden. Do you see that here? We have a partial restoration. Since the fall, God had not dwelt with mankind in this manner. Since the fall, God had not dwelt with mankind in this manner, but now he begins to dwell with the Old Testament church in a new way, a new level of intimacy and fellowship, and his presence brings something that is absolutely necessary and important. It brings life. It's life, right? God's presence brings life for his people. which is symbolized, of course, in the bread. The bread itself, right, being a symbol of life. If we are to sustain our life, we must eat. And one of the primary staples of the human diet, particularly in the ancient world, is bread, right? It didn't need to be all of this lavish food that was played out day in and day out in other sanctuaries and shrines across the ancient world. Instead, this bread was enough to symbolize God's provision of life for his people. For his people. And as we have been learning, this partial restoration in the tabernacle through the table, the bread of the presence, it's only partial, but it reaches its full restoration in the true Israel and the true bread of life. Because you see, Jesus tabernacled amongst us so that he might provide us with life. This is what Jesus says here in chapter 6 of John's gospel. He says, I am the bread of life. When he said those words, the immediate thing that the people of God would have been thinking as they were arranged around him, the immediate association they would have drawn is from this bread of the presence that symbolizes God's covenant fellowship and God's covenant off-giving and present of life. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. You see, the purpose of the bread of life is to bring us into full fellowship, peace, and eternal life with our covenantal God. For all those who have access to this covenant through faith. Because even as this table is set before us, we can see the difference here. Whereas it was only the high priests who were able to go, or better yet, the priests, and then ultimately represented by Aaron, that were able to go into this holy place to change this bread over and to consume it. Now we notice that through the bread of life, a change has happened. He not only gives us our daily bread, he's not only the king of the world in that he provides every good and perfect gift from above for all creatures. Jesus will speak about this in length as he talks about God covering the flowers of the field and feeding the ravens of the sky. But there is something more here as well. He doesn't just give us our base bodily needs, but he gives us everything that we need spiritually. And now, because we have this high priest who has ascended on high, who has climbed that heavenly Zion, who has taken his blood and put it on the altar so that we might be reconciled to our God, even as he sits at his right hand. Now, this table, this tabernacle, right, that tent has been removed. And instead, we have access to this table. We have access to the very presence of God in a fullness that the tabernacle and ultimately Eden only hinted at partially. Instead, we can come and we can sup and eat on this very bread of life. Isn't that amazing? This is a means by which God has covenant fellowship, covenant life with us, in this invitation to come to this table. This is one reason why we try to do this every single week, because now we can run to this table. We can have this very presence of God in our midst, and we can eat and be transformed more into life eternal through it. It is a perpetual meal for us that is given now in an explosive benefit of the new covenant for all God's people, rather than just the priests in the holy place. But instead, all those who are part of the new covenant of Jesus Christ are bid to come and to feast in life and fellowship, God being our provider and giving us his presence, the ultimate gift, as it is symbolized, signed, and sealed in this table. What a blessing. It is one for us that is unto our hope and to our maintenance and our sustaining, not just in general need, but in spiritual need until Jesus will return and we will participate in that final meal, that final table that our gracious host will set, the wedding feast of the Lamb, where he will partake with us. Let's close in prayer. Well, Lord, we are grateful that in this table to your Old Testament church, you taught them about your presence and your provision of life for them. Lord, even as they looked on in faith, they knew that they were waiting for something greater. They had their eyes turned heavenward, and even though they might never see it in their lifetime, they knew that there was a fuller restoration that you would give, one that was not shielded or guarded by this tent, but instead a veil that would be ripped open and they would fully dwell in your presence. And that is what Jesus, who tabernacled amongst us, that is what he gave to us. And he gave to us a fullness of life through his body and his blood, because he is the bread of life, so that full presence in your midst might be finally confirmed and restored. Lord, we await that day when the final reality of that comes true, Lord. But in the meantime, we pray that we might have the fullness of your fellowship on this earth, that you might sustain us until that time when we will eat together at the wedding feast of the Lamb. In whose name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to collect our weekly offering now. Dave, would you be so kind as to come forward and collect it on our behalf? Lou just said Psalm 24. There we go. This is a good blessing to celebrate the ascension in all these different manners. Worshipful. Well, we're going to turn to our celebration of the Lord's Supper. Will you stand with me? And if you need it, take your Trinity hymnal. We're going to recite the Apostles' Creed. I'll remind you that we do this week in and week out. These form the fundamentals of our faith. Right? Each and every one of these is precious to us, as they set the bounds of our confession, and which we cling to, because in them is presented God's plan of redemption through his Son Jesus. So we're going to recite the Apostles' Creed on page 845 of our Trinity hymnal. Brothers and sisters, what is it that you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Well, we're going to move first to our private time of confession and supplication before the Lord. So I ask that you do so now privately. Take a few moments to confess your sins before our God in heaven, after which we'll join together to do that corporately. O Lord, receive our confession in, through, and by Christ, in whose name we pray and ask. Amen. Take up your bulletin now, and let's turn to our corporate prayer of confession and supplication. Join me. O Almighty and merciful Father, you pour your benefits upon us. Forgive the unthankfulness with which we have requited your goodness. We have remained before you with dead and senseless hearts, unkindled with love of your gentle and enduring goodness. Turn us, O merciful Father, and so shall we be turned. Make us with our whole heart to hunger and thirst after you, and with all our longing to desire you. Amen. Well, we know since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Because this one Jesus, being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Well, friends, we're going to stand and we're going to sing as part of our remembrance and preparation for the celebration of the supper. Will you do so with me? And rather than taking the Trinity hymnal, we're going to take the insert that you can find in your bulletin to sing Behold the Lamb.
Sacrifice.
Please be seated. Our words of institution this morning come from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Paul will write, "For I have received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Well, to better frame our hearts, we're going to turn to Ephesians chapter 1. I'll read for us, but if you'd like to turn there as well. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23, and this passage is particularly important on this Ascension Sunday. Paul writes again, "For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us, who believe according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him up from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. For above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come, and he put all things under his feet, and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." Brothers and sisters, this table that is set before us is one of the means by which Jesus pours out his fullness to us, or his body. Notice again, verse 19, "And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe according to the working of his great might?" Brothers and sisters, there is power in this meal. Isn't that amazing? This is part of the very gift that God has given to us through his son Jesus, who ascended on high, to make these meager, simple-looking elements, to make them something that can actually transform us into the image of this Jesus who is described here. The God-man who is risen, who is exalted, who is glorified. In this table, we have a means by which we are transformed into that image through an immeasurable power and greatness of the Holy Spirit. That is a gift. That is what this table is doing. That is its purpose and its function that God has given. And notice, he has invited us to come and to partake in peace for those who believe. Friends, as you come in belief, know that the work of our Savior Jesus is being done in you, changing you, conforming you, cultivating you into vessels that are worthy and good rather than those of wrath. Does that not make you eager to come to this table? It should make us want to run here each and every week that we participate, because our eyes are turned heavenward toward this one who is exalted, who promises to change us, to make us eternal. Think of that. Right? Otherwise, we're terrestrial. We will die. We will turn to dust. Right? But as we come in faith, as we put our belief in this bread of life, we will have life eternal, and we can begin to have it now. What a gift from our present, dwelling, faithful, fellowshipping God. What a gift. It's not this time of year, but at Christmas time, when that alarm clock goes off, I don't know what you do in your house, right? But when that alarm clock goes off or that sun rises, everybody's running to that tree. Sometimes parents with coffee, right? But we're running all the same. Friends, there's no greater gift than the one that is laid out here before us. The gift is Jesus. The gift is his presence. We need to run here in faith. Like, that is why We say, with such a great gift, right, you must come in this belief, should come under the submission to the authority of the church, a Bible-believing church. You should come in that manner, right? Such is your eagerness and your desire to come that you would submit to the way that Christ rules his body so that you might too have this life and have this presence. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we do this week in and week out, and as in so many things in our life, those things that we do regularly, they can seem rote, they can seem mundane, they can seem empty of their significance and their purpose. But Lord, may it never be for us as we come to this table. We read the words that Paul's written in Corinthians and in Ephesians again, the fact that he has poured out for us a power, an immeasurable greatness in this one who is seated at the right hand of God in the heavenly places to rule and to run his church. Lord, that for us should be refreshing, it should be filling, it should be sustaining, it should be joyful more and more each time we come, each time we run to this table. We get to come and be in the presence of our head who's going to transform us. He does that in the preached word, and he does that in the visible word. See, your word is transforming us in these ways. This is the benefits of the covenant of grace. The benefit is you. May we come in faith and feed upon you. And as we do so, may we be more transformed into the image of Jesus. May we be more longing for the very presence of our God in eternity. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As I've already read, on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Friends, we've already talked this morning about the significance of the bread of life. Week in and week out, the form changes. But notice the substance of the thing. The substance is Christ. And as it is Christ, it is always nourishing, it is always sustaining, it is always life-giving as we eat in faith. Let's pray. Lord, we are grateful. We are grateful that you have set this table with your own body and your own blood. And of course we know, Lord, that these elements aren't transformed into your actual substance. But we also know that you promised to transport us into the heavenly places to feed upon you spiritually so that we might have life abundant and the life that we live might be full of faith and zeal for good works that are unto your glory and unto your honor. May this meal accomplish the very purpose. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Body of Christ, eat of it, all of you. In the same manner, Jesus also took the cup, and again he gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the remission of sins.
called upon his disciples to drink of it. Now, I didn't talk all that much about those jugs that were set next to the bread of the presence that had the drink offering. But of course, those drink offerings were poured out to God, and they were a sign of peace. We don't know exactly, we don't have the rites exactly how that was done by the priests, but we know they were there. They were probably poured out regularly. You know, in Arthurian legend, I don't know if anybody's read much of that, but in the quest for the Holy Grail, the quest for that golden chalice, only the most pure and the most chaste would have access to it, like Galahad. And even then, after they drank from it, they would never be able to descend back to the realm of the mortals. In some ways, they were actually like what's described in Psalm 24. They ascended to such a position that they could drink from that blessed chalice. Friends, that's all hogwash, right? You know, we can understand maybe some of the theology and the importance that is behind that. But friends, there's only one person who has ever been able, with clean and pure hands, as we have recited and sung and heard play from Psalm 24, there is only one who could ever achieve that level of purity and obedience and righteousness to hallow this chalice, and that was Jesus Christ. And praise be to God, because if it was up to us, right, that boat that came to collect people like Galahad in legend, we'd only ever see it in the distance. We'd never have a chance to step upon it. But instead, Christ has made it available to us. See, it was His purity, it was His righteousness, right, that paid the price so that we might be reconciled to God, so that we might drink this cup, which admittedly is not gold, unless I missed something in these little ones that we ordered for you, right? But instead, it's not the outside that is so significant, but instead, it is again the substance of Jesus Christ. Because as we drink in faith, then really we are transformed. Then we are made more pure. Then we are greater united to our Savior Jesus. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we are grateful that we can partake of this cup. This drink offering was poured out for us, not in some way that we might be so righteous and so pure as to ascend your mountain and be in your presence, but instead that it would be your righteousness that would be applied to us. It would be your blood that would wash us. It'd be something external and alien to us that you would give us so that we might come to that heavenly Mount Zion, that festal gathering where there are innumerable angels and the assembly of the saints who have gone before us praising you. Every single moment, Lord, we have come to that Mount Zion through Christ's righteousness, through Christ's sacrifice, through Christ's blood. And as we participate in this meal, we know that we are better transformed to be present there, to call upon the name of our God in heaven that has been revealed in Jesus. In His name we pray that this might accomplish that purpose. Amen. Now again, we continue to use both wine and juice. The wine is arranged on the outside and the juice is in the cups in the middle. Of the new covenant. Drink of it, all of you.
Let's give thanks. Lord, we give you thanks that you have instituted this meal to lavish us with your presence, to provide us with life. And you have done so in Jesus. May we have life abundant in him, now and forevermore, unto your glory, your honor, and your majesty. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our psalm of thanksgiving, that is, comes from Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy, for the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under us, and nations under our feet. He chose our heritage for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the peoples gather as the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. We know that this psalm has been fulfilled in Jesus Christ, who is Lord and King over all creation. Let's stand to sing our praises to him as we take our Trinity hymnal, turn to number 295 to sing Crown Him with Many Crowns. The benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Friends, now we'll have an opportunity to fellowship more through refreshment and take a little time, 15, 20 minutes or so, after which we'll gather together for Sunday school. Go in peace.